courtesy of our contemplative prayer group, and it is that joy in the Spirit that calls us together, that has formed us as God's people of faith, and a willingness to continue to respond to the promptings of God's life within our lives. And so we now still our hearts and ask that same Spirit of Jesus to descend upon us as we prepare to celebrate these sacred mysteries. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace and peace of God our Father, His Son, our Lord Jesus, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you.
Amen.
Preparing our hearts to celebrate these sacred mysteries, we ask the Lord's pardon and peace. Lord Jesus, you are Word made flesh and splendor of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You are light from light, true God from true God. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You strengthen us in holiness as we share in your body and in your blood. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and one day bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, whose Son promised to all those gathered in his name that he would be there in their midst, grant, we pray, that we may be aware of his presence among us, and in truth and charity experience in our hearts an abundance of grace, mercy, and peace. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
Beloved, is anyone among you suffering? He should pray. Is anyone in good spirits? He should sing a song of praise. Is anyone among you sick? He should summon the presbyters of the church, and they should pray over him, and anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick person, and the Lord will raise him up. If he has committed any sins, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The fervent prayer of a righteous person is very powerful. The word of the Lord.
Still and all that's alive.
I don't know why they picked Thursday night. I always thought it was because the pastor left on Thursday. But I'm here tonight to celebrate with you, and what a joy it is that this we call a house of prayer, and how the prayers and how your relationship with the Lord and so many others who have not been able to be here or who have gone before us and have been part of us from near or far. And so praise lay people, all of us we gather to be strengthened in the heart of Christ who calls us to be his people, hearing his word and then contemplating it and acting upon it. May the Lord continue to bless us and give us joy as we continue to hear that word and the challenge it brings to us as God's people of faith. I asked the priests if they would like to say anything, so we have a couple who would like to share a couple of words with you.
Well, it's great to be with you this evening, and I didn't realize that you had this contemplative prayer group here. I thank Mary Porter. Her husband Jerry and I went to high school together at Canisius. And I grew up in the 50s and 60s, and the seminary, I went to the seminary in 63, and you would say, well, you know, you're a seminarian, you're a priest, and you went through Catholic school, so you must know quite a bit about prayer. But you know, I have to say that contemplative prayer never was introduced to me or to any of us. Now, Father Michael mentioned that was he in the seminary. He went to Mount Savior Monastery down in Elmira. I have to say that that happened to me, but not a different Trappist monastery. St. Joseph's Monastery in Worcester, Massachusetts. I went with a group of priests and we went on retreat there. And it was there that, you know, we had the prior, actually, of the monastery who gave the retreat for us. And he introduced us to contemplative prayer. He would say, here we all priests, and we should have known all of this. But it was never part of, you might say, an introduction to prayer, part of the prayer life for a priest at that time. And he was such a wonderful, he taught us in such a gentle, in such a caring way that he led us into meditative prayer, contemplative prayer. And that whole week was so special because it opened a door an experience in prayer that became then part of my life now for 50 years almost, well, 45 years or so. And one of the things he said to us priests, and he said almost the same thing to us, he says, you know, people think that you have the special path to prayer to God because you're a priest or because I'm a monk or because that. But he said, I'm going to teach you contemplative prayer. And from that experience, he then said, this is for everyone. This is for everyone. And so he encouraged the priests that were on retreat, and myself included, that this should really be introduced, the contemplative prayer, meditative prayer, should be introduced to the laity, to everybody. And it was kind of an exciting time. This was in the mid-70s when I went. And I found that it was such a wonderful gift, and I've often shared it with people. It's a wonderful gift to lead people to that inner prayer, the prayer of the heart, you might say, that intimate prayer in the Lord. For many years when I was with Father Michael at Our Lady Victory Basilica, we had a charismatic group, and you might say, wow, what a difference between charismatics and the contemplatives. But I found such a union in the experience of singing and praying and meditating with the charismatic group. And it was a wonderful, wonderful crossover because it was both, I mean, they were experiencing the same thing. whether it was a meditative group, whether it was a contemplative group, or whether it was a charismatic group, because it was all directed to praise and praise to God. And that union with God that is so important in prayer. So I just wanted to share with you my experience. It didn't start early. You know, I didn't, it was grade school or high school or college. But it happened as a wonderful gift as a priest to have experience of being introduced to contemplative prayer. It has been so much a part of my life.
And we are with God. with the community of believers who participate in that life. So let's continue, and I think this is such a wonderful thing that I had discovered what Mary was doing early on, a while back. This is a great thing. I think hopefully many more parishes will be able to accept that. But it really depends more and more, because the priests are so busy and so caught up with all the daily routine that it depends upon the lay people who can really carry the light, actually, into the parishes.
But now stand and offer our prayers. But it is God's Spirit of truth and understanding and peace that we know with all of our hearts is pleasing to you. And so we open our hearts once again as we voice these our prayers, that our Lord and God would hear us and be our strength.
For the priests, deacons, religious, and seminarians, that they will feel the support of the Catholic community in their efforts to live out their vocation, we pray to the Lord. For the members of our contemplative prayer group and their families, that they will grow ever deeper in their prayer life, they spend time resting in God's loving presence. We pray to the Lord. In thanksgiving for the past 10 years, and with joyful anticipation for what God has in store for us and for others who will be invited or moved to join us, we pray to the Lord. With heartfelt gratitude for this parish community here at St. John the Baptist Church, for supporting our desire to gather here for contemplative prayer, we pray to the Lord. For all those who have been a part of our contemplative prayer group but were unable to attend our celebration this evening, may God bless them with all that they need for their spiritual journey. We pray to the Lord. For the holy souls of purgatory, they will soon move on to their heavenly home with God for all eternity. We pray to the Lord.
And for our own needs and intentions that we now pause to offer. For these and all of our prayers, let us pray to the Lord. Come, Lord Jesus, hear these our prayers that we give voice, those we have kept in our hearts, and those which you must ask for. Hear us now as we turn to you through Jesus, who is our Lord and Savior, forever and ever.
Amen.
To see all.
sacrifice of yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands, for the praise of the Lord and his name, for our good and for all of the church.
Amen. Look with gracious favor, O Lord, we pray, on the offerings of your servants here gathered, that they may truly understand and proclaim with confidence what is right and wholesome in your sight, and continue to be formed by your word, Jesus Christ, our Lord, forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you have given us Jesus, your Son, the Word made flesh, our Redeemer and Lord. He always showed compassion for children and for the poor, for the sick and for sinners, and he became a neighbor to the oppressed and the afflicted. By word and deed he announced to the world that you are our Father and that you care for all your sons and daughters. And so with the angels and saints, we exalt and bless your name, and sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. Again, and we offer you the bread of life and the chalice of blessing. Look with favor on the oblation of your church, in which we show forth the paschal sacrifice of Christ that has been handed on to us, and grant that by the power of the Spirit of your love, we may be counted now until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we have communion.
Bring your church, O Lord, to perfect faith and charity, together with Francis our Pope and Michael our Bishop, with all bishops, priests, and deacons, and the entire people you have made your own. Open our eyes to the needs of our brothers and sisters. Inspire in us words and actions to comfort those who labor and are burdened. Make us serve them truly after the example of Christ and at his command. And may your church stand as a living witness to truth and freedom, to peace and justice, that all people may be raised up to a new hope.
Remember our brothers and sisters. Let us pause for a moment and remember all those people in our lives that we pray for always, and all those who have fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to you in the eternal dwelling place and live with you forever. There, in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, St. Joseph, her spouse, with all the blessed martyrs and all those we can think of, the saints that we rely upon for their intercession before Almighty God, that we, with all of the saints, one day may open our hearts and be in communion with the Lord.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Grant us, O merciful God, that the holy gifts we have received may conform us in our resolve to do your will and make us everywhere witnesses to your word through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Be seated, please.
Let us remember we're in the holy presence of God. I decided to start this reflection tonight with that brief prayer because I feel it sums up everything that I've come to understand prayer to be. I've learned that prayer is not memorizing something and then having to recite it. I've certainly learned that prayer is not coming up with the laundry list of things that I need and presenting it to God like to Santa Claus. It's more of a two-way street. When you remember you're in the presence of God, you have to listen a little and not just talk. I learned that prayer from the Brothers of the Christian Schools while I was teaching at St. Joe's for 35 years. And I loved my time there because the brothers in their wisdom shared their spirituality with us as well as their methods of teaching. So from class to class, we would always begin with that prayer. Remembering the presence of God, going from subject to subject. And I came to realize that this is a way to live our lives. We don't take a lot of time. Our society pushes us to be productive, to be busy. And we don't take the time to listen to what God has to say to us. We always think about what our needs are and our wants, but what God needs for us, what he wants for us, is much better than anything we could come up with. So I became aware that this was a way to live my life. You could be cutting the grass. You could be washing your car. You could be washing the dishes. You could be watching the sunrise. But when you remember you're in the presence of God, it elevates what you're doing to another level. While I was teaching, I was very busy. I was raising three kids with my husband. And there wasn't a lot of time for this kind of contemplation. But one of the things that I squeaked out before I had the opportunity to join this lovely group, was I was found in the chapel at St. Joe's, and they have a beautiful crucifix in there. It's big, it's 5 foot tall, and the image of Jesus is very different because he's reaching his one arm forward off the cross, holding a white dove. So when you're sitting there looking at it, it's like he's giving you his Holy Spirit. And I used to love to just stop in there for maybe 2 minutes even, at the end of my lunch period or something, on my way back to my classroom, and just say a prayer, listen to the choir. And usually I was praying for one of my kids. Any parent understands that. And I can remember a particular time when I was in there and I was looking at this image of the cross and thinking, you know, we come up with these ideas in our heads. God will give me a vision and I'll see this bird fly somehow and I'll know that my daughter's going to be okay. She was having some issues away at school. And it was sort of like somebody came up behind me and maybe slapped across the back of the head and said, I'm holding her in the palm of my hand. What more do you want? Now, obviously, they didn't really have anything in her hands. Nobody touched me. But it was such a powerful shift inside myself. I didn't stop worrying about my kids. I'm still worried about my kids. They're all grown adults. But it shifted something inside of me to know that if I'm worrying, God's got it in hand. And no matter how it comes out, and even if I do it wrong or my kids do it wrong, he's still got things in hand. Unfortunately, we don't take time to stop and think about this very often. A lot of times it happens when something really bad happens to us. And I've had experiences like that too. One in particular I often think about was several years ago when my husband was injured working. And it was pretty bad. He ended up in the ICU with a blood clot in his leg. And if anybody knows me, I have these physical reactions. When the people I love get sick, I tend to do things like pass out or feel sick in my stomach. So I was running back and forth to the bathroom and from the ICU. And I remember thinking and being overwhelmed, I could be a widow or my husband went to lose his leg, and I'm going to have to deal with helping him learn to walk again with a prosthetic. And it was so overwhelming and so upsetting. And one of the times I was in the bathroom, I pissed by the mirror, and I looked in there, and it looked awful. And I just said, I can't do this. And I just said, God, I can't do this. And there was this peace that came over me. I can't explain it, you know. Here I am in the bathroom. Remember, you're on the holy presence of God everywhere. And I really felt a peace. And I didn't know the answer. I didn't know if I was going to be a widow or not. I didn't know if my husband was going to be okay. He's hearing me, so obviously he's fine, and prayers do work, and thank God for that. But just taking the time to surrender ourselves, I think, is the most important thing about prayer. So fast forward to our 10th anniversary of the Contemplative Prayer Group. I'm so happy that I've been able to be part of it for the last 4 years. Once I retired, I finally decided to take the plunge and do this thing that's been interesting me for so long. And it's wonderful to come here every couple weeks and to listen to a scripture. And we all listen to the same scripture, and it says something a little different to each one of us. And at the end, we share what we've learned or what we've gotten from God from listening. And it's always interesting to hear from one another. But the key is surrendering yourself. The key is taking the time to listen. And I thank Mary and Judy for trusting me with this reflection on prayer and what I've grown to know prayer to be. The contemplation part is really important. The listening is really important. And I'd like to end with the same thing I started. Let us remember we're still in the holy presence of God. Thank you.
We can stand and conclude our prayer. We won't take a vote about who gave the best reflection, because there's only one, and that's Candy. Because the priest had to get a little hot later. Lord be with you.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We go forth in peace to glorify the Lord by their lives.
Thanks
for all of you who planned tonight's celebration. The Lord continue to bless you in all your efforts, and give all of us always success to the work of our hands.